Amen. One more time. Let's give it up for the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may go ahead and be seated this morning. I'd like to welcome everybody in behalf of the pastors, Pastor Manuel and Pastor Laura, who are out doing the Lord's work today. They're in Bakersfield, but they'll be back later this evening. Amen. But before we get started this morning, I'd like to call Brother Martina so he can just give a... Amen. You can kind of... For those of you visiting or you're new or you haven't been here in a while, I'm going to let him give a brief little description of what he's doing and let him give a quick testimony.
Thank you, bro. Good morning, church. You know, we've done a few fundraisers here to raise money for a van, for a team van, and I want to thank you because we never raised the amount of money that we wanted to raise, but with the money that we did raise, we did get a van. And I'm all good to thank for it, you know, because through this church, through our Lord Jesus Christ, we have been able to make this happen. We have been a little bit at a standstill as far as going out to compete and, you know, getting prepared for shows and stuff. But now, you know, we have the van. It's an old van, but you know, it's like everything came together perfectly. You know, it's a 95 Windstar, but it only has 54,000 miles on it. And so, it's a good van, the red van, but it needs some minor repairs, and we got to get it smaller and stuff. And so, we're doing a fundraiser for to raise funds for that expense. And this is part of my team. This is all I can fit in my car. But you know, we have. You notice today they don't have any belts or medals or anything. That's because, you know, we're recommitting ourselves this year, and I've talked to my team, and we're committed to make a difference this year in our lives. You know, next time that you see us, we're gonna have new belts. We're not gonna bring the old ones. We're gonna have new belts, and we're gonna have more wins under us. And you know, God willing, we'll these kids will keep going, will keep growing up and doing what they're supposed to be doing. After the service, we're having I made some ceviche, some shrimp ceviche, and some fish ceviche for those of you that don't like either or. So I hope to get your support this time, and I'm really, really thankful for all that you've contributed. And what more can I say? I thank you from the bottom of my heart. And I know my team is very grateful also. You know, it's not you don't see many coaches that could take a carload of their boxers to church. I'm blessed because I got this group of kids behind me that are willing to go that extra mile and make that effort and fight for their dreams. Amen. So thank you.
Martina, I think he lives in like Covina, West Covina, but he travels. Oh, now it's Montebello. Okay, excuse me. But he makes the drive, you know, on his own time down to South LA to help these kids out. So, you know, if you can contribute, every dollar will help, you know, and keep that the Holy Ghost van rolling. We're here to hear from God this morning. You know, we have Brother Martin's going to speak this morning. So just welcome Brother Martin.
Come on, give Jesus praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is so good. Amen. Why don't we open up with a word of prayer? Because I feel the Holy Ghost goosebumps in this place. Come on. Father, Father, I pray right now, God, that you will have your way, God. Father, I humble myself in your presence, God. I want your word to go out today and touch our hearts, God. I don't, my God, I just pray, God, that no word be of me, God, but of you, God. I step aside so that you will have your way in our lives in this morning, God. God, I need you in this place. We all need you here, Jesus. You're the only one that can change our lives, and it's in your word, God. And I pray, God, for every person here this morning, God, that you will bless them, God, and Father God, reveal your purposes to them, God. And Father, and I pray, God, that you will just have your way in this place. And we love you. We honor you. You said, God, that if we lift your name up, that you will draw all men to you. So that's what we're doing here this morning. Yes. We're lifting up the name of Jesus. Yes. Draw them to you, God. And we pray in your name. Amen and amen. Amen. Come on. Amen. Give Jesus a hand. I'm excited. I'm humbled. It's good to see my dad. Man, that's so awesome. I'm so proud of my dad. It turns out that he's famous. I found out. I went to go do a side job yesterday, and this guy, he calls himself a mouthpiece guy, and he makes custom mouthpieces. And I started telling him, he had a sticker on his trash can right there, and I asked him, hey, so you know that boxing team or whatever, you know, and he told me, yeah, I do a lot of work for them. And I said, oh yeah, well, my dad, he trains, you know, and he asked me who my dad was, and he's, I know him. And I was like, wow, my dad didn't know me. I even seen him on TV. I've never been on TV, man. I've seen him on TV, you know, and all of a sudden I see him in fights and stuff on TV, and I'm like, what the heck is going on there, dad? Anyways. Genesis 22. Let's get into the Word of God. That's why we're here. It's the Word of God. Genesis 22, verse 15. Genesis 22, verse 15. And pray for our pastors. They're up in Bakersfield right now. They're preaching at one of our other churches, so pray for them, man. Pray that God would use them. Genesis 22, the Bible says, then the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time out of heaven and said, by myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing and have not withheld your son, your only son, blessing I will bless you, and multiplying, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is on the seashore. And your descendants shall possess the gate of their enemies. In your seed, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed because you have obeyed my voice. Because you have obeyed my voice. This morning, I want to talk about know your position. We've been on this topic all month. And Pastor Manuel has been talking about knowing our position. Because I believe with all my heart that when we get in line with the Word of God that's being preached in this house, and when we get in line and in tune with what's going on here in your church, I believe that God moves in a mighty way. And I am a testimony of that, of hearing the word that is being preached from under my pastor and taking it to heart and saying, that's not for everybody else, that's for me. Okay, I know it is for everybody else, but that is dealing with me. I'm going to take this word and I'm gonna apply it to my life because this is the season that we're in. This is this is what God is doing right now, and we need to know our position because God has a position for you, and God has promised Abraham. You know, God promised Abraham to not only bless him, but through his seed, Jesus Christ, all peoples would be blessed. I want to tell you this morning that there is a position in the kingdom of God that's been uniquely designed for each of us. Amen. There's a position. And it's up to us to make that decision to step into our position and to stay there. And I believe that when you stand in your position and you access your position, your unique position, because God has uniquely formed all of us, and when we stand in our position, that is where God's favor is, that is where God's blessing is, amen, that is where God's anointing is, that is where God's everything that you need, every resource that you need to accomplish the purposes of God while you're here on earth, that is where it all falls into place when you're in your position.
Amen.
There's a place where all heaven's resources flow to, and if we just step in alignment to it, we'll experience the power of God manifest in us first, and then through us. The power of God has to manifest in us first. God has to deal with us first. God has to deal with some stuff that we carry in us first. And I know that we're all a work under construction. Nobody here has arrived. Nobody. There is nobody perfect. We're all a work under construction, and God is dealing. The Bible says in Ephesians that the Holy Spirit is the power that is at work within us, and God is constantly at work within us, but He has to work some things out in you first before He can work through your life and to others.
Amen.
Amen. But see, there's an assignment from the enemy. Just like God has a plan, so does Satan. There are two plans, there are two purposes on this earth. There's God's purpose and the devil's purpose. Well, what about my purpose? That's the devil's purpose, homie.
Yeah, right.
That's the devil's purpose. I don't care how you try to sugarcoat it, you try to label it, God, whatever you try to do, if you're not in God's purpose, then you're serving another master, and you can't serve two masters. And we need to understand that there's God's purpose. The ultimate purpose, the purposes of God are the greatest purpose. You want to know who you were created to be. You want to know why you're here on this earth. You want to know why you exist. Then get into the purpose of God and you'll find out in due time. And God will do a work within you and unfold His purpose in your life. But it's in the purposes of God. See, the Bible says in John 10:10, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. Satan wants to kill, to steal, to destroy. But ultimately his goal is to keep us from knowing our position in Christ. Because he knows that if he has us, then he has our families as well. And if he has our families, then he has our cities. If he has our cities, then our counties, then our states, then and so on and so on. It takes one man to make a stand in this family, and everybody else will fall like dominoes. I've seen it happen. I'm seeing it happen in my life. I'm seeing it happen in my family. Because my mother stood up and gave her life to Jesus and prayed for me for years while I was out there on drugs, messed up, and just living my own purpose, living my own dream. But I came to a place where I was miserable, and all of a sudden, sin was not pleasurable anymore. It became a bondage. It became a burden, a heavy thing that held me down. But I thank God for my mother's prayer, because it was the Holy Spirit that came into my life on that day, on April 20th, 2010, and I gave my life to Jesus. I had no other way to go. I looked up, I said, God, if you're for real, then God, accomplish your purposes in my life, God. And I gave my life to Jesus. I thank God for somebody that stood up.
Amen.
Don't stop standing. Don't give up. There are those that are coming after you that will be affected by your stance in the Lord. Don't think that your stand for God is not going to affect anybody. You people are looking up to you, man. You guys in the home, people are looking up to you. Your families. I was in the home for 4 years. You guys ain't got nothing on me, homies. Why am I saying homie, man? There's a homie anointing up here or something. I don't use that word really, but anyway. But seriously, you guys stay in the home. Girls, stay in the home. Stay in the home. Your family is waiting for you. Yeah, but you gotta get right first. You have to, man, let God do a work in you and then lay a foundation in your life. And let God build something in your life so that you'll be able to stand firm on God. And when opposition comes, you won't be a double-minded person and get tossed to and from, like the Bible says, by every wind of doctrine. And you'll be able to stand and say, no, this is what I believe. No, this is what I'm standing for. No, I've been fighting this whole time. I've been sowing. And yeah, I haven't reaped yet, but I know that one day I'm going to reap a harvest if I don't faint. And believe me. See, the devil wants to still kill and destroy. Satan's goal is to blind the church from the truth and rob it from its destiny. Satan's goal. I'm not talking about the world. The world's already blind. We're to love them. We're to reach out to them. We're to preach the gospel and share Jesus with them. I'm talking about the church this morning. You're the church. Satan's goal is to blind you and rob you of your destiny.
Amen.
Well, how could you say that? I've been saved for years. Well, I mean, examine your life. Where do you stand? What is your stance? And we need to understand this, because there's nothing more powerful than a church that is in position. There's nothing more powerful than a man or woman of God who know their true identity.
Amen.
See, we have a true identity. And for many years, I lived a false identity. You know, there was purpose behind it. And everything that I went through, the Bible says that everything that the enemy turns for evil, God will turn it around and work it for good. And so I see that, yeah. But I lived a false identity. Let's not forget the fact that we lived a false identity before Jesus. And so your true identity is in Christ. It's in Christ. But you have to settle yourself. You have to make up your mind and say, you know what, God, I'm done trying to live this other life. I know you have a better life for me, so I surrender, God. I don't care how bad it hurts. I don't care, man, all this stuff that's trying to hold me back. I'm gonna cut some people loose because I want to get around people that are heading in the same direction. And so I'm going to do what it takes. I want to change in my life, but not just that. I want to change in the ones after me, my little ones that are looking up to me. And so I want change. And so what do you got to do? You got to make a stand. You see, all power, all authority, and all dominion rests in knowing and standing in your position.
Amen.
You want the power of God? You have to be in your position. You want authority? You got to get under authority. You got to get in position. You want to have full dominion? Then you must be in position. Church, when we know our position and we stand in that position, we unlock the blessing of God. We unlock the blessing of God. When you know your position, you know who you are. I'm a child of God. No longer am I a slave to sin. No longer am I a slave to Satan. I'm a child of God. And I'm standing in my position. And this is where God planted me. So I'm going to get planted here. Under the preaching of my pastor, this is where God has planted me. Because if you don't have roots, you ain't gonna grow in your position. And so we got to stay planted and rooted. And so when we know our position, we unlock the blessing of God, not only for ourselves, but for our offspring.
Amen.
That was the promise that God gave to Abraham. And God gives you the same promise. Every promise that's in the Bible that God gave to somebody, whether it was Abraham, David, or Paul, or anybody in the Bible, you got to understand that promise is for you as well.
Amen.
That promise is for you. And God has promised you to not only unlock an inheritance over your life, but unlock an inheritance for your offspring. Because there is an inheritance in store for us. And when we unlock that inheritance, we can unlock others' inheritance. But only if we're in position.
Amen.
Only if we're in position. We need to be in position. We need to make up our mind. We need to cut some things loose and reprioritize. What are your priorities? Examine your life. You know, is everything else before God? Is God secondary, is what I'm trying to say. I don't know about you, but I've never seen anybody that made God secondary in their life to get very far. They might have became religious and just, you know, their whole life was just a window of religion, and all you see is calisthenics. But you never see the power of God moving their lives. You never see them go through trials and stick it out and be shaped and molded into the man and woman that God has called them to be. You got to be in position. We must be in position. When we're in position, we're able to hear from God. You know, there's a lot. I've heard many people. I hear from God. You're not in position. When you're not in position, you don't hear from God. You're getting. You're like that double-minded man that the Bible talks about, tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. And that's what happens when we're not in position. One day we're here, the next day we're over there, the next day we're listening to this and listening to that influence and being influenced by this, and you're not in position. We need to be in position. So how do we access this position? Very quickly. I got 3 points. How do we access this position? Number one, we need to be clear on our current position. And this takes being honest with ourselves. We must have an honest view of where we are in life and the decisions we've made that got us there. Look at what Paul said in Philippians 3:12. He said, "Not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me." Paul had an honest view of himself. He was being honest with himself. He says, I don't got it all together.
Come on.
Don't think I got it all together, brother.
Yeah.
That's what he's saying.
Yeah.
No, I have not obtained. I have not arrived. I'm not there yet. I'm being honest before you. Don't look at me like I'm talking about Paul. He's saying, don't look at me like I'm there. Don't look at me like I've arrived somewhere. Me too. Hello. Yeah. Shoot, talk to my wife. Anyways. But Paul was honest with himself. We have to be honest with ourselves.
Hallelujah.
He had an honest view of himself because of that, he was able to see where he needed to be and made an effort to do everything in his power to move towards the high call of God. Because he had an honest view of himself. Because he knew who he was and where he was at, he was able to see, okay, I'm here and now I gotta get there.
Yes.
And because I'm honest with myself, I'm not believing my own lies. Hello, because we could do that very good.
Yeah.
You know? And we could think we're at a place that we're not. And so we need to examine our lives and have an honest view of where we're at in life. Only then we'll have clarity. Pastor Man has spoken clarity all month.
Amen.
We need to have clarity. Clarity will give birth to vision, and vision will move us toward our destiny as we are led by God. We need to be clear on who we are. We need to have clarity of our life and the condition of our life. Hey, it's okay if you're all messed up. So am I. We're all messed up. We need God. And, you know, but it takes a person to admit that. To say, man, I'm jacked up, man. I just, man, I don't even want to mention what I did this morning. Oh, what I did last week, man, I'm just gonna, you know, I am jacked up, and I need God. I really need you, man. I really It takes clarity. You need to be honest with yourself. You know? See, a lot of Christians, after being saved a while, become familiar with God and begin to think they're at a place in which they're really not.
Come on.
You become familiar with God. You know what to say. You know the lingo. Praise the Lord. Amen. You know, and God bless America. You know, we know what to say, and but see, we get familiar with God. Oh yeah, God. Yeah, Jesus is my homeboy. You know, and we begin to we lose that fear. You know, we lose that conviction. You see, when we become familiar with God, we begin to think that we're a place that we're not. And that's being dishonest and out of position.
Wow. Come on.
That's being dishonest. You don't have an honest opinion of yourself, an honest view of yourself. And so you're not in position because you're lying about yourself. And so you're not in position to receive what God has for you, the transformation that God has for you. And see, check this out. Being in position is being honest with God and ourselves. You got to be honest with God and yourself in all areas of life. Understanding that His grace covers us when we fall short and enables us to get it right.
Amen.
Amen.
See, when we're honest with ourselves, that we know that we fall short every day, man. I'm not trying to set up a fall short today, but your word, God, says that I'm going to fall short today, and if I fall short, God, I know that your grace is going to cover me. I don't have a plan. I don't have a license to sin. I know that. I understand that, God, but I know that I need your grace today. It's your grace that covers me. And not only does it cover you, but his grace enables you to get it right. Can I make a mistake? Thank you for your grace, God, that I'm able to get it right now. To make some changes. It's your grace. It's your grace, God. It's God's unmerited favor. Number two, we must be led by conviction. Pastor spoke on conviction all month. We got to be led by conviction. John 16:8 says, and this is Jesus speaking. He said, and when he has come, he's talking about the Holy Spirit, he will convict the world of sin. I don't know about you, but we have a sinful flesh. We have a sinful nature.
That's right.
And God will constantly convict us if God is in us. But if we're not convicted, if we're able to, you know, have a smoke and have a drink and continue to live the way we used to live and look at porn and have an affair and not be convicted, then there's something wrong. I would check my heart. You know what? You're not even saved.
That's right.
Because you need the Holy Spirit to convict you, right?
Yeah.
If you don't have conviction, you don't have the Holy Spirit.
Man.
The Bible says that we can continually sin and we can submerge grieve the Holy Spirit. We can grieve him and he will leave. And he will leave if we continue with our sinful habits. Hey, you can come to church and you can continue to do all your religious calisthenics and continue to come here and I go to church, I feel good about my conscience. You know, there's people like that, you know, that feel good just coming to church. They feel good about themselves, but there's no conviction. There's no conviction, and whenever they hear a message like this, they get very uncomfortable. They leave the same way because they're too proud to say they need God, they need forgiveness. They leave the same way. Amen. Conviction keeps us, if we desire to remain in our position, then we must live by conviction of the Holy Ghost. Check this out, conviction keeps us in alignment with our position.
Right.
You want to be in position, you need conviction in your life. You need the convicting power of God in your life at work with you constantly. I feel conviction every day. Oh, you must be sinning every day, brother. Yeah. The Bible says I fall short every day. And I will be honest and I will admit to you
that
yes, I fall short every day. I had to make mistakes. Am I still getting drunk out of my mind? No, God cut away all the outward sin. I don't do that stuff anymore. I stopped having multiple girlfriends and little parties and whatnot. And, you know, and I used to be the kind of guy that get high with myself, you know.
Because
I don't want to share, you know. You know? God cut away all the outward sin. Did you know that you can sin inside your heart?
Right. Yes.
Did you know that you can have a wicked thought towards somebody and you committed a sin?
Yeah.
Did you know that you can murder somebody in your heart?
Oh,
did you know that you can have a lustful thought towards a woman and commit sin in your heart?
Come on,
did you know that pride is sin?
Yes.
Did you know that you can just have a sin party inside all day long? And nobody will even know it, you know? And so I constantly have to check my heart. God, I did. That's not right. I shouldn't be feeling this way towards my wife. I shouldn't be feeling like that towards my brother in the church.
Come on.
That's wrong. God, forgive me. I forgive. I forgive, God. Forgive me. God, I'm letting go of this pride. I'm letting go of this pride, God. I'm sorry. But, you know, I treat people wrong when I'm proud. Forgive me, God. And we have to be led of conviction. Well, you might say, well, I don't feel convicted. Check this out. It's 2 Chronicles 7:14, one of my favorite scriptures. If my people, this is God speaking, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. See, the Bible says that if you pray, God will convict the hell out of you and you will repent. Right? I don't know about you, but whenever I can get to, you know, sometimes I don't want to see God because I don't want to repent, you know? Anybody like me? You know? But when I begin to seek a holy God who is righteous, who forgave me of so much, when I begin to seek him and pray and say, oh God, then I feel convicted. I feel the Holy Spirit at work within my heart. Oh God, I repent. I repent. And you say you don't have conviction? Get close to God. The Bible says if you draw close to God, he'll draw close to you. But you have to draw close to God first. See, godly conviction leads us to repentance. But be aware of condemnation. There's a difference. Some people feel condemned and they think that's conviction. That's not conviction. If you're led of condemnation, it's gonna destroy you ultimately. And because in the same way that God leads by conviction, Satan will also lead by condemnation. And condemnation will keep you out from moving in your position to being bound and led away from God with guilt and shame. Remember, Satan's time is running short.
That's right.
Some of us gotta settle that in our heart. Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
We gotta be right. Satan's time is running short. And he'll do anything to keep as many as he can from knowing their position in God. Condemnation will pull us away from God and magnify emotions of guilt and shame, but conviction will draw us closer to Jesus. God, our loving Father.
Yes.
See, we must have, number three, we must have courage in knowing our position. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 16:13, be on your guard. This is Paul speaking, telling the church of Corinth. He said, be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. You might ask, why do we need courage? Because many times, check this out, listen carefully. Many times, as God is doing a new thing in our lives, it's easier to draw back out of fear. Right?
Yeah.
You're living a whole new lifestyle, like, and God is leading you. And sometimes we get fearful. Oh man, I'm fearful of taking that step of faith. Fear of the unknown can keep us from experiencing the life that God intends for us. Fear. Fear of the unknown. That's why you need courage.
Amen.
We need courage in order to act on our faith. We need courage. In Joshua 1, God is so good, man. In Joshua 1, as well, stand to our feet. We're going to bring this to a close. In Joshua chapter 1, God is instructing Joshua to be strong and courageous because he was about to lead the nation of Israel into the unknown where God promised an inheritance. See, God promised Joshua, I'm going to give you everything that I promised your ancestors, but you got to be strong and courageous, he told them. Because God knew that sometimes, you know, we can get discouraged when we're walking out the plan of God. And discouragement will knock us out of our position. And so God knew Joshua. That's why he repeated it. You know, and whenever God repeats something, he's saying, listen up. You're going to need to be strong and courageous, Joshua. And you're going to need to work up this courage. It's in the mind. And you're going to need to work up courage in your mindset. And have a courageous mindset, because what's up ahead, I'm going to give you the land, Joshua. I'm going to fight for you. You're going to see the walls come down. You're not even going to lift a finger. You're not going to pull a sword. You're going to walk in your inheritance, but you have to be courageous for the journey that's up ahead. And sometimes when opposition comes, and I know because I've been there, I know I'm speaking from experience. Everything that I've been speaking on, That when it gets, sometimes you feel like God is not even with you, and you're just, man, what is going on? God, you promised, God, what happened? It's not going according to the way I thought it would go, God. And why am I in this position? Why am I, man, why do I feel like giving up? And God will speak to us. You need to be courageous, because everything is discipleship. Everything that I'm leading you through right now is part of my plan. I'm molding you. I'm shaping you. I'm putting my hands inside of your heart. And I'm putting away all these things that have built upon your heart for years. All this hardness, all this stuff that you accumulated in the world, I'm getting rid of it. But I have to put you through the fire. I have to put you through opposition, because that's the only way. You can't take off paint without sandpaper. You need sandpaper. And you can tell when that paint is rough, because you gotta rub it harder with the sandpaper. And sometimes maybe that's you this morning. Maybe you're in a place right now, And you're feeling the effects of all the opposition, because we're living in some crazy times where lawlessness is running wild, and anything goes nowadays. And maybe you're feeling it. You're feeling the oppression. You're feeling it at your workplace. You're feeling it at home. Oh, your family is not saved, and you're the only one serving Jesus. And man, it's tough, because they're always just trying to pull you away from God. But let me tell you something. You keep pressing forward. You'll be strong and better. Courageous. At the right time, God will release a blessing upon your life. At the right time, you will reap if you faint not, if you don't give up, if you continue to press forward when all hell is breaking loose and the enemy comes in like a flood. God will raise up a standard in the midst of your enemies, and you will be sheltered by the great and mighty warrior. The Lord is a mighty warrior, and he will hold you, and he will shelter you, and he will carry you in those times when you feel weak, as every head is bowed right now. The presence of God is in this place. Hallelujah. Every head bowed, every eye closed this morning. Holy Spirit, have your way. God, we need you. We're desperate for you, Jesus. It's only your presence, God. God, we lift up your name in this place, God. You said, if I lift up your name in the midst of all your people here, that you will draw people to you. God, perform your word this morning, God. Draw them to you, God. Draw them to you right now. Touch the hearts of your people, God. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I don't know what you're going through. You might be here for the very first time, and you don't know nothing about Jesus. Well, let me tell you. That tugging that you feel in your heart, that's the Holy Spirit drawing you to Jesus. And he wants to be everything to you. You've been looking in all the wrong places. You've been searching for love in all the wrong places. It seems like the cocaine always runs out. It seems like like you're never satisfied with that girlfriend. You got to move on to the next one. Or that boyfriend, you got to move on to the next one. It seems like all these things, and you're exerting all of your alleys and passages, and you're just tired. Jesus said, all you who are burdened, come to me, and I will give you rest. And this morning, if that's you, you want to receive Jesus, whether for the first time, or maybe you're here and you know that you got sin in your heart and you haven't repented and it's separating you from God. Or maybe you're caught up and you're still living a lifestyle of sin. Call it what it is. It's sin. Call it what it is. It's sin. You need to repent this morning. And if that's you, you want to receive Jesus, whether for the first time or you want to recommit your life, I want you to lift up your hand very quickly. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody? Anybody else? Come on. Don't pass up this opportunity. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else? Do not pass up this opportunity. Maybe you're shacking up with somebody, and you know it's wrong. It doesn't matter if you have kids with her or him. You're not married. Maybe you're still messing around. You're in sin. And this morning, we need to repent. and turn back to a loving God that will wipe away our sin and forgive us. And if that's you, you want to rededicate your life, lift up your hand. Come on this morning. Anybody. Anybody. God bless you. All those that raised up your hand, take a step of faith this morning. Come up here. Let's pray. Come up here. Don't even think about it. Come on up here. Let's pray. Take a step of faith. Take a step of faith. Come on up here. Come on up here. You want to commit your life to Jesus for the first time, second time? God is a, as long as you got breath in your body, you still got an opportunity to get right with God this morning. Come up to the altar right now. I'm going to lead you to prayer. And it's not the words that's going to save you. It's the sincerity of your heart. You mean it with your heart. And this morning we're going to pray. Just repeat after me. Lord Jesus, forgive me. Heal me. Restore me. Put me in my position. Have your way. I believe in you. Thank you for saving me, forgiving me, and everything you're doing right now in my life. Have your way, Jesus. You guys can hang out in the front right here. I'm going to change the order of the service. I want to open up the altar to anybody that wants to come up here. Don't ever turn away from the altar. The altar is a place of repentance. The altar is a place where we exchange our filthy rags for God's righteousness and God's grace and our and His mercy. I don't know about you. I never want to get hard, my heart hard towards the altar. I want to keep a broken heart. I want to always go to the altar when I know I got things to deal with this morning. Come on up to the altar.